Jamali 9000.
How accurate is your Wikipedia?
I don't think it's actually. I've never. This sounds weird. I'm not a big looker at it. I think mine's so basic. I think it is just like maybe things I've done.
I've had people aggressively ask me when my birthday is because I won't put out when my birthday is.
No.
I won't tell no one. And people ask me why, and I go, because you don't need to. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
If you're going to send me a present, why'd you give a shit? And it's that weird thing of, and I've had. Who actually messaged me? The official Instagram of celebrity birthdays.
Fuck.
Messaged me again. Could you tell us your birthday? We're getting a lot of inquiries. And I'm like, no.
No,
it's none of your business.
But I'm also very private in a sense. I sort of learned quite quickly. I don't want to put up pictures of my family or my wife or anyone. Like, I just find that weird. I mean, this is actually a weird thing we say about birthdays. It's like, and this is a thing that. Like social media and stuff does, like, just fucking drives me mad. So there's a thing now that you put on Facebook, right? Mm. Where people are like, instead of a present, give to this cause. I'm like, I haven't seen you for 20 fucking years.
Yeah.
What point did you
and think? Now you're hitting me up for money.
Yeah.
It's like since I had done a TV show, I've got boys I ain't spoken to in years that have been like calling me from jail.
Yeah.
Like, hey man, you know, like man's been caught selling tobacco. Can you hook me up? They're like, bro, like... you in years and now you're calling me from jail asking for fucking money, bro. This is what do we have an iPhone recording now? Fuck me, my god, the budget is,
oh, wow.
Just, I'm about that the budget is just descended on this show.
This is so 18 cameras.
Yeah
is like, this is what happened to a lot of stuff from Big Brother.
I wonder what this bit here is, because it's like, there's just like a palm tree
that was on my rider. This is like,
that's what you demanded.
Yeah, they were on the phone to me and they were like, what do you want? I want a moving palm tree and a pink...
What is that decision not to have you? Because I don't put my family up either. What is it that about the family that just is a no-go for you?
I just think it's like, I think you have to be... Like, there's you make a choice when you get into this business. Mm. What kind of, like, performer or what kind of presence you want to be within it.
Yeah.
I come from, like... I got into this game late. There's certain stuff that I don't feel like I want to share with my family. So I just made that decision. And like, not quickly, I sort of like, I'll tell you what it was, right? My wife went out with some friends and I put a picture up. This is a couple of years ago. And these guys said, oh, you're Tom Davis's wife. And like, I was like, they followed me on Instagram. They weren't aggressive. There was nothing to it. But I was like, oh, mate, that's a weird thing that they've clocked her.
Yeah.
But in any other circumstance, that they were nice guys. They were lovely. They were like, but that there's an eye opening moment there. And also, like, I sort of, you know, I'm a creator of the stuff I do. I'm a writer, actor. I don't like the word celebrity. I don't like the word. I think fame is like a ghastly thing. And now I kind of think like we're slowly seeing like the sort of like. Result of fame, like with you know, we talk about anxiety and whatever, and that can happen to anyone, and that is a sort of a modern problem because we're all looking at everyone could be doing this or doing that, but there's these people, and also it's so fleeting, right?
Mm.
You can go on something and you can be on every paper and everyone's talking about you and you're everything, and literally within 6 weeks, everyone's forgotten who you are.
Yeah,
and I think that's like, so what you make a deal of what kind of fame you want, I think, and so I'm always gonna. I'll put a picture of me and you up quite happily because
I'm in the business as well.
And I'm a big fan of your stuff, and it will do loads for my kudos.
Hey, listen, man, listen, don't, listen, you know, them ats, when you get those ats and then you get the follow. It's always good to do, there's certain people where I know I would like the people that would like them.
Yeah.
Because there's certain people where I'm like, oh, please don't put me up on your gram. I don't want them. I don't want them coming because they're gonna think I do what you do. Not because they do bad stuff, but it's like I don't make that stuff. So it's like I don't want to disappoint the people. Like, you're not like this person who posted you. I'm like, yeah, I never said I was.
It's a weird thing, isn't it? As well, of like who you think like. So I sort of made a real thing early on, like never to get. I never asked really for pictures. There's times now when I look back at people I've met and think, oh, like. But then, like.
Who have you regretted asking a photo from?
I did a thing, a film a couple of years ago, and it was like Brie Larson. It was like, this was before her Oscar, Cillian Murphy. It was like a really amazing cast. I got a picture of Ben Wheatley because he's a kind of cool friend. But like, but then also there's a part of me that like, so this is a really interesting. Like, I was the other week, my dad came up to see me. We went to a garden centre.
Mm. Yeah.
It's a new life for me. It's like trying to set up an abode. And we're like, we're in this place and we're having a jack of potato and a chinwag. And this kid comes up and he's like, oh man, can I get a picture? And my dad's like, flabbergasted, what? He's like, what do you want a picture of him? And the guy's like, oh yeah, I just really like his stuff. He's like, yeah, what do you want a picture?
Yeah.
And I was like, considering for a lot of my youth, the proudest thing of our whole house that my dad showed everyone was a picture of us and Frank Bruno.
Yeah, you saying that, I know who your dad is. You know what, like, bloody Frank Bruno, mate.
Trying a picture of Frank Bruno.
Yeah, it's Frank Bruno, mate. He calls him Frankie to his face. He goes, all right, Frankie, get a photo of me and the son. Don't fuck about, come on.
Get a picture of me and a boy, Frank, yeah,
come
over
come
here,
on,
son.
Come on, Frankie, come on, son.
Like, everyone clench fists.
Yeah, you know, you want a photo like that. That's the classic photo.
Have
of
you
like,
seen the one Muhammad Ali did with the Beatles? Yeah. Like, you're punching right for us.
But that's the proudest thing, yeah. Hell yeah.
But then you're like, do people sit there? And he's like, so he couldn't get his head round, like, what do people just have these on your phone? And then, so there's a part of you that thinks like, although I don't have pictures, I have those memories of hanging out with those people, yeah, and talking to them. So what do I need a picture for?
Well, I think the picture of that really does come down to, and not ego, because ego is sort of like a broader sense than what we make it, but it is sort of just like it's like when I do a show and someone takes a photo of me and I go, but when are you ever going to look at that again?
Yeah.
All you're going to do is going to post it to get a couple likes, which is a new currency, but there's never going to be a time where you doing that is more enjoyable than the thing.
Yeah. Like, you know? I remember seeing, like, you go and watch a band and you'll see people filming a band and watching the band. I'll tell you, actually, this is the most fucked up thing. I was on my honeymoon and we were at Lake Garda.
Mm.
And it was me and my wife, and we're sitting. It's beautiful surroundings. It's like romantic. It's incredible. And over the lake, there's this massive thunderstorm, right? And I'm like, fucking hell, like Mother Nature is best, ripping the shit out of fucking mountains. So I'm out there. It's raining. We're out there watching the thing. And like, there's a few of us around there. And you're like, oh, fucking, this is like, you know, it's beautiful, but it's great chaos.
Yeah.
I come in, and there's this fucking guy sitting with his phone watching a YouTube video of thunderstorms. I'm like, you fucking prick, it's out there.
You can't enjoy the moment.
Yeah, it's like, I wonder if there's ever been a better thunderstorm.
Yeah.
There's one here.
It's just that, it's that thing, isn't it? It's that thing of, because we have unlimited thing, it's even we want it of our own lives.
Yeah.
Of that moment. That moment, I just don't think it'll ever be the same as the... I guess we're different because we kind of have to exist in the moment to work.
Yeah.
That we kind of want to experience things as opposed to being like, let me see it through a screen.
But yeah, but then there's also an interesting thing, like when you look at like my mum and dad have got photo albums that can cover 5 years.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And there's just about enough photos to go back to, and there's loads of them unfinished.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And but then when you look at those pictures, it incites a memory. It's like so much thing. And my worry is that in years to come, it's like, we'll just have everything there.
Yeah.
So it's like, and also what's the greatest thing of our lives, right? And what me and you do for a living is we create stories, right?
Yeah.
So 90% of what I say on stage started somewhere.
Uh-huh.
But like, I come from South London, I have a God-given right to bullshit because that's the only way that anyone would talk to you in a pub. So over the sands of time, all of that changes. The memories from you or me, from this conversation, but now it's been recorded, whatever, but they change and they evolve.
Yeah.
But now it's just like, oh, no, it didn't happen like this because there's you and Kevin standing.
Because there's something about telling a story or having a story of something and then sort of adding the spice to it that we're going to lose.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, it's like, you've got to put a little bit of like, I could tell you the story exactly what it was, but you want to put a little bit of spice on it. And we're losing that. So just to go back to that moment, because my dad, there was this boxer called Colin McMillan. He was a welterweight boxer. My dad would drive past his house, and when you see him, my dad would wave at him. I go, do you know him? He goes, no, it's Colin McMillan. And my dad never met him. But every time he would drive past, he would bib his horn and wave at Colin McMillan. And I was like, why are you just waving at this man who boxed once? And then my dad just like, but my dad thinks he knows him now. He's like, it's Colin. It's not Colin McMillan.
It's like that, like via my dad. So Phil Tufnell, my dad would see in a pub every now and again. And I was chatting to him, and it was when I was really in the infancy of my like career.
Yeah.
He's like, you should talk to Tuffers. Tuffers will be out. Tuffers will be out while you're in. He's doing loads of stuff on the TV. Have a chinwag with Tuffers, right? And we're in this pub, and Tufnell come in with his wife. And my dad was, oh, there's Tuffers over there. You go and have a talk with him. And I was like, oh, I don't know, I was, you know, a bit conscious. How well do you know him? He went, oh, just watch this. All right, toughers. Phil Toughnell looked round and he went, see, he knows me. I went, you've just fucking chatted his mate out in the middle of a pub. Of course he's done, man. Went over and chatted, he's never met my dad before.
Yeah.
He's been in the company of my dad when he's drunk.
Yeah.
It's a weird thing of that age group, like thinking they have an ownership. I'm just conscious that I'm loud anyway and I've shouted.
No,
the sound man's ears just went like that.
That's it.
I just like the idea of him being someone going, I used to be a sound man.
Yeah. till I recorded Tom Davis. That's his job. I'm just gonna make a real loud scratching noise. put another microphone near this to make that sound. But you grew up in Croydon, so.
Croydon and Sutton, Croydon, Earlyon and Sutton. Do you know Sutton?
Yeah. I done a gig in Sutton. I done this gig in Sutton, right? It was a Manfred's gig, and it was one of the new nights, and there was no one there. There were four people there, and there was this one guy who was just a geezer. He had big brother, wearing a shirt. It's a Friday, we're wearing a fucking shirt. Wearing a shirt, he had all these gold chains. He had where they wear the gold chains, he had the boxing glove on it.
Yeah.
He had all these rings.
Never boxed.
He'd never boxed in his life, but he's boxed someone, but not in a ring. I remember he's just sitting there, big governor, you know? And I done a gig for him, and he was just like, you know, and he hated it.
it's that sort of place.
Yeah.
It's a weird, yeah. So it's like, Sutton was like such a crazy place because you had sort of like that in the centre of like Croydon and Kingston.
Yeah.
And Croydon and Kingston.
Kingston's a weird town.
Kingston's a really weird town.
Kingston's a weird town because it's London, but it ain't London, and it's sort of on the border.
And it's like where people go for like a birthday.
So
Sutton is 20 minutes away from the West End, really, on a train.
Yeah.
And that, but that would be like once a year. They go, like, even now, people can't get their brains around. I'll be writing in Soho.
I'll
be there like most days.
You go
like,
central all the time?
Central all the time. How do you do that? How's the commute?
You forget that. There was a time where Central, I remember for me, because I grew up in Ilford, and Central London was sort of fetishized as this place. Like, oh, we're going up Central.
Yeah.
But now it's just like, you know, it's just an everyday occurrence for me now, isn't it?
Yeah, because it was like Camelot. It was like this kind of crazy thing of like... Yeah,
you had to wear shoes when you went Central. Oh, you wouldn't get into the club, mate, if you didn't wear
Sherman,
shoes.
Ralph.
Yeah, I came from like the Ralphie, right? I used to have this Ralphie polo long sleeve.
Oh,
in white?
Yes.
Ooh.
Patrick Cox, one
you
of these.
Stop it.
And Never leave eyes.
The boat shoes, God. Yeah, you're damn right. The boot cuts.
My boot cut. Well, I remember someone telling me in a pub about Patrick Cox. He's like, they give you a lifetime guarantee. That means you can have them forever. And if anything goes wrong with them, you give them back. I was like, I don't know if that's true. And this guy used to work it. He was scaffolding them almost. He had them on every day for every situation.
When did you move out, Saf?
I kind of moved into town. So I lived in Bermondsey for a while.
Yeah.
And then now I live up more north. I live like sort of just outside Peterborough, which is a crazy...
You live up north.
Yeah,
yeah. What's that pace of life like?
I like it. You know what? It's like... My wife's from there, and I was conscious, so the most important thing in your life is always going to be, like, the person that you settle down with, right? Mm. What you realise is our career is like a bit of like a roller coaster. You can fly in it which way. So what the most important thing to do is have something at stake, especially if, like, for my state of mind and who I am, it's like, I think to have something that, like, that's bigger than this, and that's what my wife is. She's that thing. That's the thing that's the reason I work as hard as I do, and that's the, you know, because the stuff I've been through with her is bigger than any of that, any of this, so my thing was like, look, you know, I could be touring, I could be away filming, and she wants to, I want her to be around her people, like her family, her friends, so she's got them nearby. Like, that's the most important thing. That's her life isn't not jeopardized, but isn't
dictated,
she's, you know, dictated decisions by what I do. And it's important to remember that. I think I try and make this as a normal job as it can be.
Mm.
Like, it sort of, I work hard for it. It's like,
have you always sort of had that thing of this, I'm going to treat this like a job and not just treat it like a sort of a, because it can become all consuming.
Yeah.
And it could become a lifestyle.
Yeah. But
as
then,
a job.
Like, my thing was quite quickly, like the first couple of years when I was single and the first stuff I did was like more, like, I felt, oh yeah, I need to go to every networking party, I need to go to everything.
Yeah.
And actually, none of that resulted in any work. The work will always result in more work.
Yeah.
So, like, when people say, like, it's, you know, like, for you now, it's all concerning because you're doing gigs, right?
Yeah,
but then during the day, you're free. So if you had a wife or a girlfriend. I don't know what your situation is.
No, 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 single.
But like, you'd spend the day with them potentially. email in. But so my thing is like, I sort of was like, I find those networking things quite difficult. I find them like you can stand around. You're never going to pitch an idea to when you're pissed out your head and like.
Well, you realize that those networking parties is they're there just to be like people are more concerned about being seen there than they actually are. It's 'cause I've never booked a meeting.
No.
From being there. They either want to meet me or they don't. They're going to see me at a party and go, well, we did turn up to this party and drank a pint of cider, so I guess.
And he was as drunk as someone from Love Island.
It
feels like we should probably give him a chance.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's like, I'll get more done if I'm up in the morning. And like, so I worked a long time working, doing jobs like, on building sites or market stalls and whatever. Mm. So that always meant getting up early.
Did you sell at the market?
T-shirt. So I did T-shirts and jet leather jackets.
Oh, yeah.
But I did, like, festival stalls.
Yeah.
So basically, me and my friend were doing that for a couple of years.
Oh, so going to music festivals.
Glastonbury, Tea in the Park.
And what type of teas were you selling?
Well, we were selling, like, slogans that never really sold, but we kind of just thought,
your own slogans?
Yeah.
And what was one of the slogans?
Well, the biggest selling one was just cunt.
Yeah, oh, okay.
Just the word cunt.
Yeah.
And we sold a lot of
this crazy units.
Because we were at Tea in the Park and I was like, this is going to be crazy trying to earn money here, because like, we were trying to really think of these wacky sort of slogans, and wacky is the word, and then I was like, what if you just put cunt on a t-shirt, see if it sold? And we had them at Tea in the Park, and the Scottish guys were like, hey, fuck. I want one for the whole family. Sold out like in a day, and it was like, fuck. Like, we were, and then we took them to Glastonbury. The first thing I was ever on TV for, I got interviewed at Radio on Weekender.
Yeah.
And the guy's interviewing me, and he's like this hip kid off like Newsround or whatever, going, oh yeah, it's great here. Welcome to everyone's going crazy. One Direction are playing. You're a market still holding, you're selling t-shirts, what's the vibe type thing? And in the background of Newsround, it's just like 80 fucking cunt t-shirts and jumpers. So we were like, I did that for like, when I was scaffolding, I was like, look, I need to have something that brings in a little bit of money that I can try and do this stand-up thing full time.
And was you working the road, or was you just doing London? Or?
No, we worked all over. So I was doing that, and then
with the stand-up.
Manchester, Leeds.
Was you in the clubs in that? Was you doing the club gigs?
Yeah, I mean, like round in London more. I think Manchester, I did quite a few. I sort of, trying to think of the name of the early on. It was just like sort of near Chawton. There was one there.
Mm.
I did the store, laugh. Manchester store. No, I did. Oh man,
was the one that Jason Manford used to own, the Chawton one?
I think he had something to do with it. He played there. Peter Kay played there.
That was way before my time. But I know Northern comics talk about that club. Like it was an
amazing,
the Holy Grail,
it was an amazing place. So I ended up in Manchester for like a while. I'd met this girl at this festival, and I'd split up with like a long term girlfriend. I met this girl and I was like, wow, like she's incredible. And like, we were sort of hanging out at festivals and doing whatnot. And then like, you're like, wow, we're just like, she's in, like, and then you take away a festival life and we're both living her flat.
It's a reality.
And it's like, oh shit, man. Like this has been a really bad life. I met Jason Manford for the first time. He's a cool.
Did you know Jason Manford? I went university in Manchester. And he had come, and I was doing stand-up a little bit then. I think I'd done one Edinburgh, like a compilation show. And the course I was doing, there was a stand-up module. And the teacher, and there were third years. I was in the first year. And the third years had done stand-up in front of him, and he critiqued it. And I remember he said, anyone else want to do stand-up? So I thought, I'll go do stand-up. And killed. It was in this little room. It was just classmates in the third years. Killed. Had like a good set.
Yeah.
And then Jason Manford just sat there and went, yeah, just quit uni, mate.
Really?
Yeah, he said, just quit. And I went, what? He goes, yeah, just quit. And my lecturer was like, oh, I don't think. No, he goes, no, you're a comic. Quit. And then I quit. And then I saw him about 2 years later. I had doing like some opening gig for him. And he goes, oh, so you took the advice and you quit then? And I was like, fuck yeah.
He's a cool guy,
Yeah, like, good dude.
I before I moved up to Manchester, I went and did a thing in, they had like Manchester Dance Hall, did like this Manchester kind of comedy festival, sort of like it was, it was like a dance college type thing, and they tried to over like the summer holidays type, like put on this like
use the venue.
But it was a fuck off massive room, right? And I hadn't been going that long, and then the room, like they're like, you know, it's a day of comedy, you know, it's like they're really thinking it's going to be like something else. And by the time I got on stage, there's like 15 people in a 250, and one of those people was Jason Manford. And this is a long time ago, man. This is probably 8 years ago. And
damn, so he was like, this is when he was just breaking as well? Yeah. He'd probably just done live the Apollo stuff.
And he was like, really then, this is, and it's a testament to him. He was like, really lovely, you know. He was like, look, you know, you could do this, you do that, drop out this, drop out that. He was like, and it, do you know what? It's like, that's the most important thing of, I think, being a stand-up.
Yeah.
Is the people, I remember the people along the years who sort of took that time, Joe Brand and like Jim Jefferies, like a lot over the years, who sort of give you that little bit of Tom Stade. I remember like giving me some amazing advice backstage. Like the first time I did the store, he was like,
It's always the first comic that's nice to you, you remember. Especially the first big comic that's nice to you. Go, oh, wow, man. That's the, like, I remember it was John Bishop was real nice to me. Like, he let me do
his He's TV. A lovely guy, man.
He let me do, because he had let, so I was kind of maybe, I must have been going, was I pro for 2 years? No, I might have been pro for like a year. That's, I was still doing comedy, but I'd just become pro. And obviously Cameron Banks, who was working for his production company, I don't know if he still does. Cameron Banks is a good dude. And he had asked me to do John Bishop show, but obviously John Bishop has to pass it. And he let me do it. And he let me do the John Bishop show. And he was like, well, this is why I want to break new acts. And he was lovely to me, saying he liked my stuff. And he was just such a nice guy.
It means
guy,
the world though, right?
Yeah, it's like 100%.
It's, you get that validation from people early on, who like, who enjoy your stuff, that you're fans of.
Yeah, it really makes you, because when you start comedy, especially, or anything, you feel like you're here and they're there.
Yeah.
And there is no, I can't even imagine that.
Yeah.
I remember like when I first started doing comedy, because I've done Live the Apollo twice now, and I remember when I first started doing comedy, I hate saying credits, I sound like a cunt, so sorry out there if I sound like a piece of shit. But I remember when I started out comedy, that idea of doing that show was unfathomable. Like you just, number one, you didn't see people like me on that show. Let's just put it what it is. You just did it.
It was
the ilk of that.
Yeah.
And you know, and the idea of doing that was just, you know, like, because people say to me like, oh, you must have fulfilled your dreams. And I'm like, the only dream I had in comedy was genuinely, the only dream I ever had is I went to play Amsterdam.
Yeah.
And I remember the first time I met my agent, I had a meeting with him, and he was like, so what do you want to do? You want to do TV? You want to do movies? I was like, I want to play Amsterdam. And they went, yeah, all right, mate. What else do you want to do? I want to do a gig in Amsterdam. And they laughed and they were like, all right, we'll get you a fucking gig in Amsterdam. But just the idea of gigging in Amsterdam was the peak. And I did it, and that was, and then everything else has just been downhill. But
but the dream changes, right?
Yeah, the dream
like,
changes.
When you're talking about that sort of, I remember like, I did a thing with Partridge, like I'd done like a few, like, so when I first came into, I hit the ground running in this industry.
What was your first, was that your first project?
No, so I did a thing called Shimon Selector with like Keith Lemon now.
Oh, okay,
Death of Michael Jackson. I played John Landis.
Okay.
So he got me into that. And then I did a thing called The Morgana Show,
mm-hmm.
which was like a sketch show with Morgana Robinson, who's a fucking man, a phenomenal talent. But then I just went quiet for about a year. I didn't, nothing was coming in. I was doing stand-up, but nothing active.
And you were full-time?
Yeah, but then I was like, shit, man, this is different from being a scaffolder, where my whole life up to then had always been a job that I knew I was getting paid on Friday.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, I'm like, fuck, this
that
is
di-
not,
that, yeah. that diary's empty.
Yeah, and I'm like, oh, man.
Yeah.
And also, like, people, there's a sort of, and I found it quite quickly, people had this, like, you know, I'd say like a middle class attitude that, oh, you're a scaffolder. I mean, that must have been tough. Like, I was like, I was on good money. I wasn't like, it's a weekly
wage.
Yeah. But also like, it's a trade. I looked down their nose at a trade and it was, but I remember the day that like, so then I got a call from Coogan to do Partridge and he was like, but like he phoned me and I thought, why? But he was like my hero. The guy was the ultimate for me. Like, it still is.
He's one of the funniest people we've produced.
And so I went and did this day filming with him, and he did like Alan Partridge released his book, and he did this iBooks thing with Robert Popper, who's another fucking hero. He's another guy. But spending a day watching him, just learning from him, but him saying nice things was like, you know what, like, crazy. That's an incredible thing. get that feedback from an idol.
How did you get your first gig? Did they catch you from stand up and offer you the role? Was you auditioning? Was your agent sending you for auditions?
I was through a friend who was like a sort of, he'd worked up from a runner and he was doing like production bits. And it was like, I've been doing stand up and then he wanted to direct. So me and him just started going out at the weekends and just like filming characters and filming things.
There's one question I'm curious about is, you see, because you're a big dude, you're what, 6'7"?
Yeah.
6'7", big dude. Did you find typecasting the motherfucker?
I'd moved like early on.
Because you do roles that, so like, it's even like Murder and Successful. Yeah. Is I could, and I wouldn't think that, but yeah. I could imagine like a you know, someone in a production or casting going, well, we just, you know, like you're more of the villain.
Yeah.
Or something like that. But you know, it's like you have really sort of been, you do some roles that you go, yeah, fuck yeah, man. Like, you're not going to stay in that box. So it's that weird thing that people do when they're making movies or TV. It's just like, well, you know, they can't be 6'7". I'm like, well, you don't think people out there aren't 6'7"?
It's a weird thing.
Like, what do you mean? You can't be 6'7" and be a doctor. Well, yes, you can.
All this stuff I did early on was like, never in my accent, never in my voice.
Yeah.
I was always very conscious never to let people, too many people know this is how I talk. Like,
yeah.
Because I thought, And then as soon as sort of people sort of, you start going in for casting meetings, just meeting people, it was like a raft of scripts came in. Oh yeah, you're playing a guy who's doing up someone's house. You're a builder. You're a doorman. You're a tough thug.
I can imagine someone looking at you going, that's our doorman.
It's like, it's a lack of,
creativity on their mind.
And it's like, and you go in, it's not even interesting doorman. Like,
I'm not being funny. Some of the most scariest doorman I've ever seen have been tiny.
You think in your head, tiny. How many scary big men you've met.
I'm
suffering. Do you know how hard I've got to work for people not to be scared?
I'm not
Shrek. Get away from my swamp. I'm an affable kind of guy.
I love it, man. Them little doormans are the ones you've got to worry about.
I find that in life.
Yeah,
I find those guys, it's like, even when I walk my dog, when you see, there's always like the yappiest dog will be the smallest.
Yeah, because you know, because I'm not going to make you repeat the story, but it was one of the funniest stories when you tell me about the one you did with Dane Baptiste.
Oh, yes.
That guy was small. Yeah. And look what he did.
So, yeah. that's what you're talking about with Sutton.
Yeah.
That guy, I went to a party, I think I was 15, 16, and I walked in with a girl, and this guy was like, oh, look at you. You're a big fucker, ain't you? I bet I could roundhouse kick you in the head. And I was like, oh, you probably could. Like, I don't know, you might know karate and shit. And he was like, you saying I can't? Right, so completely the opposite of that. And he's like, this fucking guy thinks I can't roundhouse kick him in the head. And everyone, like, I'm 16, this guy's about 40. And everyone, oh, mate, oh, he's mugging you off. Yeah. Next thing I know, I'm on the floor, knocked out, Sparko, and he has roundhouse kicked me. I mean, fair dues. And I came to on the sort of like, someone pulled me over near a sofa. And people went, oh, mate, that was so funny when that guy kicked you in the head. And I was, instead of going, no, it wasn't. It was fucking akin to child abuse. It was kind of cool, right? Like, and Dizzy looking around he's sort of like got my girl and he's like chatting her up.
Fucking
and she's
piece
like,
of
yeah.
shit.
Yeah, man.
Well, that's the thing is that dude had some mad insecurity.
Oh, yeah. And but then I sort of went, yeah, it's terrifying, man. You've got, like, and you still come up with it. It was like, I went into a pub just the other day to watch a football at my Jacks, and I was just like, walked in, and this guy was like so aggressive. He was like, well, you police. And I was like, well, number one, like, if I was, like, I wouldn't be telling you. But number two, like, do you think that everyone back at Operations Centre or whatever it is going, you know what, we should send someone in undercover? Who? You know, Big Tom. Like,
the fucking, 6'7" and massive.
The most standout fucking guy in the whole fucking
thing. He's going to really slick in there.
I have a thing with fucking idiots like that. Like, what do you think you're doing that's so bad that the police are fucking interested? Yeah, doing a bit of coke on a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, really, like, going to bust this case wide open. Really going to, we're going to have to send the top guy.
No one gives a fuck about you. Your wife's having sex with a gardener somewhere. Yeah. It's like,
and she's loving it. But so I know you're standing back up to stand up now. What made you go back? Because a lot of people would like, they sort of, they do something and they go like, you know, I don't want to do it. Because the stand up is, it's a lot of... effort to put in. What made you go back to it?
Like, firstly, it was like a weird thing of like ego, probably.
Mm.
Like, I started off and all I wanted to do, I loved stand-up as an art form. I loved it. Mm. I really like enjoyed it. And then when I first came along, like first started doing stuff, you know, and it's when I first saw you and like, I had a voice that wasn't represented, and a lot of people weren't talking how I talked and talking about stuff I talked about.
Mm.
Like, not many people have been drop-kicked in a fucking
party. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then somewhere along the line, I got people were like, oh, you need to make it more mainstream. Don't talk about this, don't talk about that.
Mm.
And I sort of went, oh, if I'm not talking about that stuff and I'm not talking about what I want to talk about, then I'm not talking. I'm, fuck it, I don't want to do it anymore. I'd rather write and rather
act. It's not your voice anymore. Yeah. So what's the point of
I tried doing stand-up like that and hated it.
Yeah.
And I felt like, you know what, I don't want to sell out, because I felt like I did a couple of times. I did the Apollo or whatever, someone came to watch me and I didn't do the stuff I felt that was what I wanted to talk about. So I was like, you know what, if it's not truth and it's not honest, then like I don't want to do it.
Mm.
So I sort of like just sort of walked away, and I've never really thought too much. It sort of always irked me a bit, and I was like, maybe it is work, hard work, but also it's the most rewarding thing that you can do as a comic.
Something about killing.
Yeah.
You know, there's something about, and especially like getting a bit what you believe in.
Yeah, yeah.
And then saying it.
And making people, but then the second thing was kind of, this is like I spent a long time writing and performing in a thing called Action Team. Like that was the second thing out of the traps out off after murder, and it was like something that was like really close to my heart, and it was something I really believed in, and it didn't hit like murder hit. It wasn't like as like, you know, murder was a success really from start, you know. Mm. Grew nicely and it didn't, you know, and it kind of,
how many seasons did you get in murder?
Three.
Yeah great.
And then yeah, so like Action Team was like, oh fuck man, this isn't really nailed it. And it was like not like depressing, but I felt the same pangs of like I felt when I first started stand up, and I was like, and I'd give them sort of almost two and a half years to making that thing, and then it's like, oh shit, it's like it's just not hit home, and that's just life, right? You can't get too big.
Nothing's gonna crack,
but what my thing was is like, I need to have an outlet that I'm gonna be able to go out and talk and make people laugh day to day. Like whenever I want, I can pick up a mic and I can go out and do that. And also like Ramesh and Catherine and people like that were like, go and do it. And like, even if it's like, and again, but I'm now doing it with the same sensibility that when I started, I did it because I hated my life. I genuinely hated scaffolding.
What did you hate about it?
Just the monotony. And also like, I read Billy Connolly's book, and there's an amazing part in that where an old man tells Billy about like, go and be a professional musician.
Mm.
If you want to do it, go and do it. Because there's nothing worse than being an old man.
Mm.
Doing this. And I used to look at the guys who were 60, 65, who were sort of married twice and in a pub every night, and think, I don't really want to do that. And I felt like I was slipping into that world.
Yeah, I mean, it's an easy road to get into that.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's so easy. I remember because when I first started doing comedy, because my mum and dad are quite different. Like my mum, sort of working class background, but kind of, you know, worked her way up to when I was maybe in my 20s. And sort of, and her mindset is just, well, you know, you do this, you do that. God bless her. You know, she's a worried woman. You know, she's looking at her son who's a bum. And, and she's terrified. You know, I've never held down a fucking job in my life. You know, I'm saying? I was a bum. And then my dad, who's like, you know, working class, painter, decorator. And I remember thinking, my dad's going to give me the most shit about this stand-up stuff. And my mum was sort of like, you know, well, if you're going to do it.
Yeah.
But my dad, I was like, I know he's going to be like, what the fuck are you talking about stand-up?
Yeah.
And I remember I spoke to my dad about it, and my dad just looked at me and goes, listen, don't listen to no motherfucker. If you want to do it, you do it. Because my dad wanted to be a footballer.
Yeah.
Fucked up his knee, couldn't do it. And my dad was like, don't let no one tell you nothing. And he saw that thing of, you know, because I think sometimes with, you know, coming from working class backgrounds, the problem is we're not taught to aspire.
No.
And then, you know, and just through the sort of generational thing, we're not taught that that could be us.
Yeah.
And, but then, you know, it's what we should be doing is teaching our things. Listen, we've got to be the next.
But also, it's an interesting subject matter when, like, so I know, like, what we've just done a thing now with young kids who have come out of similar backgrounds from us. And, like, but also, it's like, I look at it deeper as being, at school, I had, like, ADHD. I was, like, dyslexic.
Oh, me too.
So, but then I was always told I was pretty much stupid, or I wasn't very good, or thrown out of class. But I was amazingly creative. Yeah. I was good at art. I was.
Did you have that one drama teacher?
No. I sort of had a RE teacher.
Yes.
Which is weird because I was sort of, my mum's like atheist, but my dad's Catholic. It's like, but he sort of kind of saw, I guess, something. But I was creative. So So like now when I go and talk to kids at schools and stuff, there's always like a kid who's fucking about. Yeah. And they're always like, oh yeah, watch out for like.
And he's the best one.
Yeah, yeah, but he's the one you're like, he'll be the guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But what we do is we sort of, and certainly in our generation, people didn't really notice that and they just saw it as pissing about.
Yeah.
But actually some of the most creative kids are going to, and you know, but then you, the worst thing you can do from any child or anyone is you take away hope. You take away dreams. As a kid, you should be a dreamer. He's a great mate, Uncle Buck, where he's like, oh yeah, this kid's just a dreamer. Like,
yeah.
If you're fucking 12, man, you should just be dreaming of it. Yeah, you should be thinking.
I remember, it's another thing I don't think I've ever spoken about, but because we're on the subject, I remember that breaking point I had, and it took me years to get over it and to stop letting that affect my life. But I remember, because I've got dyslexia, dyspraxia, and ADHD, and I had, you know, it's something I probably haven't admitted in public too much, is I was semi-literate writing. I couldn't write. To the age of, you know, to my late teens, I couldn't write anything that was legible.
Yeah.
Couldn't write. And I remember I'd done this thing. I must have been early, man. I must have been like year 7, year 8. And there was a teacher called Miss Hanley. I'm gonna put you on blast, Miss Hanley. and she goes, what do you want to be when you're older? She tell me back at the end of the class, when you'll be, I mean, I was a kid, I was like, a lawyer.
Yeah.
And she goes, you will never be a lawyer. And I'm like, that shit fucked me up until I was in my, you know, to my late things. And it is that thing of, you know, we take these kids and we tell them that, you know, they're this, they're that, just because it isn't the right trajectory.
But also, you know, it's an interesting thing of like, I look at kids that I was at school with and like, you got to learn to lose early. Because life, you're going to do that. Life, you're going to go for a job you're not going to get. Life, you're going to want a girl and not going to get her. Or a guy. Whatever. Life, you're going to have to get used to fucking manning up and getting used to losing. Now, if you're a captain of the football team, pick for all the school plays. If you're the kid that the teachers are like, this is the most amazing kid we have here. Like at school, you're like, you're peaking at 15.
Because
it's downhill from there. It's like,
life gets
like,
real quick.
Like, the guy who's running your company that you're going to go and offer for a job, he's been fucked in the ass.
Yeah,
you're that kid.
He's the kid that everyone wrote off, or the kid that you bullied. Yeah,
but he's got enough fire in his belly to start that shit.
Man. You got some hunger, man. Easy. You got some hunger, man.
Yeah, and it's interesting, like, it's an interesting thing to, I sort of like, I was writing the thing and I went back to see the kid who was that kid and he's just like got nothing about him. But in my mind, like you're saying about that sort of social thing, I went to meet him and like he's rocking a pair of Morels and like a super dry fat face t-shirt type thing. Yeah. And I'm like, oh mate, he's like, I remember him as being like, oh God, just let me have a day in his shadow.
Yeah, yeah.
And then like, he's just turned into this fucking waste man.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
like,
melt.
Yeah, and he's, yeah, and that melt is the word.
And you know what it is though? It's that life, man. That life, that Momo shit. That's what I try to tell them, you know, because just for some context, we just done a workshop with some kids who want to be creatives. As I tell them, don't be squares.
Yeah.
Don't worry about what squares are doing. And that goes to people out there, even if you're not a creative out there, just fucking, even if you, if your thing is banking, be the most unsquare banker you can.
But people worry, and we worry about it more and more now.
Yeah.
Because everyone else's life is on show.
Yeah.
But I remember talking to a kid and like talking to him about getting a what we deem as a real job. And he's like, why don't I get a real job where Joey Essex is a millionaire and doesn't know where Africa is? And it's a hard argument to have. Because you remember when we were kids, I mean, I'm a bit older than you, but you had like Bullseye and Gladiator.
Yeah, yeah.
A Bullseye, even in its smallest context, you had to be good at darts to get
There was some talent involved.
You know, and Gladiator, you had to train well. Like, we cultivate in a society now, which is kind of just like, like, he's stupid, but he's funny to watch, but he's a millionaire.
Yeah.
And that's a dangerous thing, because that's telling people that they haven't got to, like, push themselves. Like, they can float through life.
Yeah.
And it's like, I spend every day of my life, like, slightly regretting I didn't pay a little bit more attention at school. Like, although I'm... life would have been easier at times.
Yeah.
But also, like, I've spent years trying to persuade people I'm not stupid because of the chip on my shoulder.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going, like, you know what? I think everyone's going to think because the way I talk, the way I, like, as a big guy, there's a common perception. So I think, oh shit, I've got to show people I'm brighter than I am.
Do you feel like that translates into the stand-up as well?
Oh yeah.
Do you feel like in the stand-up there is that sort of thing of, because it's easy, I haven't seen your stand-up yet, I'm interested to see it though. We should do some gigs together.
I'd love that, man.
Let's book a room and let's do half an hour each. That'd be fun.
I'd love that.
But anyway, so it's that thing of, you know, because it's like, there is that easy thing, like you could, you know, like, and I've got it too, where I can go up there and just go, beard on my face, you know what's up. And it's just like, you know, and it's that thing of you kind of
got to create pressure. It's certain rooms that I always think like, oh, I should go in there. Cause, and also I was always conscious of like looking 6'7" skinhead. Mm. Like some places they're like, oh yeah, yeah, great, mate, fucking hell, love of it.
Oh, now for some real comedy.
Go on, mate.
Now then. Get the old cigar out. None of that liberal shit.
So I was always conscious. Number one, to not be that, to show people quite quickly I wasn't that person.
Yeah.
Like to put that into context. But then there's a thing of like, so like anyone, I love stuff where you're like, your gears are ground. I like tiny things like that make you really annoyed and stand up. But then I was also, I didn't ever want to be the guy who came on and was like, oh yeah, I'll get your light bulbs changed.
I referenced
the elephant in the room.
Yeah. Of course you have to,
But then like, I wouldn't have like long rambling routines about a time that I hit my head at house or like, you know. There's a million and one people have got jokes about me being tall.
And there's more to you than that.
Yeah.
What was the first stand-up you watched where it blew your shit?
Oh, do you know the
Did
first...
Did you have that moment?
Bernie Mac is guy where...
Was it the Def Jam set?
Yeah. That's the guy that's the... Even now, I can look and that's inspired me. Even now, I look at like the most inspiring guy that I thought was like... It felt like he was in control of the taps.
Yeah.
And he could go hot and cold or he could do whatever he wanted. And it was just like a thing of... Like, I was obsessed with that, those tapes. But Bernie Mac... And also, what I loved, right, is you... And this is what I'm trying to do now in a really... Like, he then had a sitcom which was kind of mainstream about him adopting his...
Yeah, the three kids.
Which was beautiful. Most amazing thing is Bernie somehow managed to take... this like hardcore stuff that he was talking about in Def Jam, which was like edgy as fuck, and then putting it into a like 6 o'clock show that people
and that whole routine, the whole routine about his sister. taking his sister who's a crackhead, and taking and looking after the kids,
and it was still in that thing,
He was
still talking about it. You're talking 15 years ago, he was still talking about it.
There was something about a good sitcom. There's something about when a sitcom sound like Atlanta or you know, one of those type of sitcoms where it just hits. And you just go, there's something about it. There's something about a good sitcom where you just go, the mechanics and everything about it.
It's like
amazing.
People to notice, right? Like, and go, "That's I know someone like that." So, like, although Bernie Mac, like, on paper was a million miles in a sense away from, like, where I was at the time of my life, he was the most, like, the time where I was like, oh, this guy, I know this, like, and, like, this is how I think about the world.
Yeah.
So I think Bernie Mac was probably... But then Murphy, like Eddie Murphy, I love the characters and I love the fact that
whole routine he does about calling up his dad after he's been punched in the face.
Yeah.
And it's just, and then the stuff about the barbecue, that whole long routine going about to the see barbecue. Rocky. Mate, all
going
of that.
To see Rocky's
and it's
great.
Just, and it's just that whole character.
The hamburgers.
Homemade
hamburgers.
And it's just the build.
Yeah.
And how he builds it and structures it. And then it's just like he becomes each of those characters with no makeup, no dress sense, nothing. Just
voices and the act, you know, his, and then you just think of like, and then Billy Connolly. Like now, I went to see like Catherine Ryan the other night at the Garrick, and man, like
fire.
I did a really early TV job with Catherine, and like was just blown away of her. Then like, just had something like you don't want to say like the X Factor, but my God, like and like seriously, like to watch her at the Garrick. You're like, it's like she's just, I think, almost like, you know, she's like the perfect stand-up.
Mm.
And you know what she does? She's dealing with very, very relevant current situations. But Catherine, the beauty of Catherine is there's always a joke.
If
it's not in there, there's no, you don't ever feel like you're being like lectured. Yeah. It's like, this is funny first, but it's going to incite some sort of like thought. And she's incredible.
I think that's what I like about great stand-up is, and I think because it's laughing, people look at it like, we can't laugh about that. It's like, no, you can.
Yeah.
It just because we're laughing at it doesn't mean we agree with it. Doesn't mean that it's we're making fun of the subject. But there is humor in that sort of thing.
But also, you have to talk and laugh about stuff. Yeah. And like, you can't just like serve people up like warm pap and pretend that like that's a, like, you know. Everyone in this country at the moment, and in the world, really, like, you know, you're talking about the Western civilization. We're all like in a position, I think, where so much could have been done if we'd been talking about this instead of hiding away from it. Like, you know, it's like you sort of like now find ourselves in a position where we're, you know, it's a scary place to be, right? You know, you watch your documentaries and you and sort of, you know, Robinson or whatever, it's become more and more prevalent, it's more and more of a worry, you know. And that sort of feels like a throwback to a place that we thought we'd moved on.
Mm.
And yeah, that's something where you sort of have to sort of go, shit. And maybe like, maybe the most, one of the things to do is, you know, get out there and talk about, you know, and you haven't got to hit people over the head with it. No. I don't think there's anyone in this country who's not fucking sick to death of hearing about Brexit.
And you know what, man? Like, it's like, you know, again, like, I think there's just as much power in telling some dick jokes, man. Like, we need to chill out sometimes. Yeah, you got to.
I love a dick joke.
Yeah, I love dick jokes. Mate, fucking the main bar, thing man.
That we do here is our job, right?
Oh, it's dick jokes.
Dick jokes.
Like, we've been sitting here for nearly an hour talking about, like, the relevance of social stuff. But really, guess what? We just want to talk about pussy and dicks. That's all we want to talk about. But that shit's funny.
Yeah, but
do you know the funny
people half an hour a day, like they'll watch us an hour a day, and that's the time when they haven't got to think about that shit. So yeah, let's
the most fun I've had on my tour talking about race and feminism and all this type of stuff is when there was a guy with glasses and he had like bald head with the white hair coming back, and I called him Professor, and that was the funniest happened to me the whole tour. Is that called a guy Professor?
Oh,
and
mate.
that was a, you know, and that's because sometimes you've got to have fun. Now,
man,
you know?
Yeah, my favorite things is like. Play, you know, still now, I like a juvenile joke. I like to go in, like, when you're shooting.
A fart?
Or melting chocolate and putting a tray at someone's tray in the toilet and thinking, putting a room around that someone's got diarrhea. I think that's great.
What's that? How long do you normally spend on sets?
Depends on the job.
Depends on the job. What's the longest you've done
doing,
set for?
When we were doing Action Team, we were like away for like 8 weeks. So I was like breaking into producer's room and like putting his shoes in the freezer and.
Shoes in the freezer.
ordering shit to his room and like, yeah.
Where'd you film that?
That's Bulgaria, man. That's some dark stuff over there.
Yeah.
That's like...
There's certain places in Europe where you go, God. Like, I went Ukraine. And when I was driving around Ukraine, I swear to you, bruv, there was potholes a foot wide and a foot deep. Madness. And there was this one time where we had these drivers and the drivers would drive all night. And they would drink Red Bull and vodka and smoke fags. That's all they did. They didn't speak a word of English. And one of them, one time, he just reversed on the motorway. And he just reversed on the
they
motorway.
Have no laws
and
when
it's like,
shit.
You're reversing. And he just giggled and went, it's Ukraine. And I was like, well, all right, fair enough, man.
They, I love that. I broke my finger doing a stunt when I was out there.
Yeah.
And they like took
you
me to
hospital.
Yeah, man, I'm that kind of
finger
motherfucker. Stunts. Yeah, finger stunts. Yeah, like you know when you see someone scouring a map.
Yeah. He's like, the one doing this. Done that himself.
Tom
right?
Davis for the map scouring. Yeah. He's amazing at that. So they were like, "We'll take you to hospital, get a reset type thing." So we turn up, and it was me and Andy, who's a producer and like an interpreter. So in this hospital, and a woman's like, you need to go down to the fifth cupboard on the left. And I was like, cupboard? Jesus Christ. And we're sitting there, and then this woman came in, and she'd been beaten up bad. Her arm was in a sling. And I was like, looking at her, and I was like, fuck, that's horrible, whatever's happened to her. And I said to the interpreter, I was like, is she all right? Is she okay? And he starts talking to her. And he's like, she's a prostitute and she's been beaten up. And I was like, oh, man. And I looked at her and I was like, put my hand up and I nodded and was like, you know, oh, you're okay, you're okay. And then she sort of smiled and came and sat next to me and started like trying it on with me. And I was like, wow, your work ethic.
Yeah,
it's like incredible.
You should try putting that in the Fortune 500 company. You out here hustling. Yeah, you know I'm saying you'll make a million. You got $1 million business in you, babe.
Four broken ribs. And then they took me into their cupboard. And the guy
and was there a cupboard?
Yeah, like it was tight, but there was someone doing washing up in the corner. And the interpreter was like, the guy basically started talking to the woman, and I was like, what's happening? And she's like, oh, he's saying about your finger, it's broken. I said, oh, I know it's broken. And then she said, I'm just going to tell him who you are. So she turns around, says something in Bulgarian. He looks me up and down and says something. I said, oh, what did he say? She said, I said, this is Tom Davis. He's a big actor, very, very famous. I said, well, I don't know about very. And, in England, and he has hurt his finger. Can you look after him? I said, oh, what did he say? And she said, he said, I don't give a fuck. And then he got a piece of Coke bottle, like a Coca-Cola bottle.
Yeah.
And he came over and put that as a splint and then just tied sellotape around my finger. Genuinely, and I was like, the fuck is this? Like, you know, and he's like, this, I have no other options. This, we have nothing here. And I had to go around, like, you know, and it wasn't, he didn't even clean the Coke bottle.
It was still sticky.
Smoked the whole time, like blowing smoke in my face. But it's like, fuck, that's the other side of the, of the world, man. You're like, fuck. Man,
there are some places in this world.
And he said, this is my favorite thing. He went, you want CD-ROM picture of your x-ray? Serious. And gave me a fucking disc. I don't even have anything left now to play this on.
Yeah, yeah. You got to go buy an old Dell and try and wind that in and see what happens. My God. So are you planning to do a tour with the stand-up? Sorry to keep on going back to stand-up, but I find it crazy that you're like, I'm really stoked to see it, man. Because I know you did stand-up. I never got to work with you.
I think...
You plan to do a tour? Like, maybe. Get an hour together?
I'll get an hour. I want my guy up to Edinburgh and doing like work in progress. Oh, dope. Like, have a time up there. But yeah, I don't know. You know what? I'm just enjoying going out and talking to crowds. Yeah, talking to crowds and having some fun doing that. It's been like, that's been a like really enjoyable thing. And also because like the sitcom I'm writing is kind of biographical. It's
about the sitcom. Tell me about the sitcom.
So at the moment, we've shot a pilot. We'll see what happens. But it's about like me growing up and like sort of where I kind of sort of see myself in the world now, and it's about me trying to match up to the man that my dad is, and it's about like, I guess, like keeping up with the Joneses type thing. It's like shot in South London, and like the thing I want in it is having just like real voices. I was talking to you earlier about that. I don't want to have like, I hate when I watch something and I see like a guy coming in and he's like doing a Courtney voice like that, mate. And you're like, oh, fuck off. Like, just get, yeah, we can come up, mate. And it's like making sure that the people, the stories that we're telling are stories that people will relate to. So Stan has been great for that. It's been good because some of the stuff that I was pissing about with has now made it into like that pilot.
Great.
Like thinking about, you know, my dad, and he's bought this world's sharpest knife, and he's like, calls it the son he never had. And like you have, yeah. So those, that sort of, and you know, and it's like the little things. It's like fun.
What did your pops think about the whole?
He loves it, man.
Did he like it?
Like I couldn't ask for anything. Like my parents have been incredible. Like, and it was like, you know, the moment I shot like my first thing, which was about an overweight debt collector who joins Weight Watchers. That was a pilot I did years ago.
That sounds hilarious.
It's a lot of fun, man. And that was the first time he was like, man, I'm proud of you.
There's something about the proud geezer dad, or the proud brother dad. I remember there was a song, I used to hear this story. It's like, you know the guy who played Billy in EastEnders?
Yeah.
His dad would carry around headshots of Billy signed. Handing them out, be like, you know my son, you know he's Billy from EastEnders.
It's lovely though, right?
Yeah, it's beautiful. Like, I'm not taking the piss. Like, I think it's so nice that it's that sort of thing of like, my son is doing this. I cannot stop my dad commenting on Facebook. Yeah, this motherfucker's posting shit about shows that have come out and are done. My dad's like, yo, I've seen my son. My son's doing a show. My show's doing a show in Luxembourg. I'm like, dad, you know no one in Luxembourg for you to be spreading.
My dad's
this.
Like that now. With like, yeah, I've told everyone down the pub, so the viewing figures will be all right. It's like you've told 20 people.
Yeah, don't worry.
Croydon's
watching.
I did like the Paddington 2 movie, and I went down a pub to see him, and he told everyone I was doing it. And I went down and one of his mates turned around and he went, what's Paddington like then? And I went, well, he's not real. He went, what, going up his arse a bit? And I'm not, to this day, I don't know if that's a joke, because if it is, it's amazing.
That's hilarious.
Or if he genuinely thought Paddington, there was a bear.
He's gone up.
They changed.
They're always fucking changing.
Yeah, those bears. No, they're known for it. No, that's why Rainbow finished.
Yeah.
He became a cunt.
Yeah. but that's the thing, man. It's about getting them stories out there, isn't it?
Yeah. And, you know, it's a nice, you know, like yourself, like if you die on stage, there's nothing.
Did you die a lot in the beginning?
Man, yeah.
Yeah.
I can, like, even now, yeah.
I got deaths I can still taste. I remember one time, I did this gig in Hornchurch, Essex, and my dad come. And my dad was like, as he walked in, he was at a pub, and people were paid to stay in the pub to watch the football. So like, I'll pay a fight, I just want to stay in the pub. And I've gone on, and I'm dying. And they've come up and they say, you need to get off stage. I'm like, I ain't going nowhere. And the guy was like, I'll still pay you. I was like, all right, bye. And I look and I was like, my sister's there. And I'm like, where's dad? Where's dad? He goes, he's in the car. And no, my sister's gone. And I was like, dad, where's Rio? He goes, I've told her to start the motor. I knew it was tasty when we walked in. My dad had sent my sister to go start the car because he knew it was going to be that. I knew it was going to be tasty. We walked in here, son. We're going to start the motor. And where my dad was, and he's like, and he used to, you know, and he came for that one. And he's come to, he likes to come down. Doesn't
my really dad's never come to them. And I went to, do you know Download Festival?
Yeah. The music fest.
Yeah, I remember like I did one of the first times at the comedy tent there. And,
with the metal now,
like I was dressed. I didn't know what Download was at the time. Even though I was doing festivals, I was like kind of like a little
hush puppies.
And I was wearing like Ralph, Nike Air Max. I was like, and they were like, "Oh, have you got to change your clothes?" Because like, and Jason Rouse was headlining.
He was Jason, a thousand rings.
Yeah. And some pretty fucking like horrendous views on the world.
Wearing a t-shirt of a virgin getting murdered.
And everyone's like, "We love you." And I was like, they called me at, like, they're like, you know, right, you're gonna open, and like Phil Nichol was like, "I can't let this guy open. It's fucking like, you know, it's like Land to a Slaughter." And I was like, "Oh, yeah, I'm brave. I wasn't scared. I fucking went out, and man, it was like a baptism of horrible fire. They were shouting, the heckling. As soon as I walked out, tried to drop some material, tried to like
crowd work something,
man. Just like they hated me, and then like the bottles of piss started flying.
Oh no!
Like, I think they were pissing. Mean,
like, bottles of anything, but probably piss.
Yeah, but and then the guy, and I had the opposite from you. Like I was like, "Can I come?" Like, and they were like, "No, you need to finish your shit, man." And then like I got out, and I somehow offended some people because I was kind of like, you know, I'm like, you know, fucking, if they're gonna throw this at me, I'm gonna try to throw something back because I can't just. Anyway, I remember like getting in a golf buggy where they take you to like off-site and then you get into a car and I was just like holding it in and holding it in, got like a full fucking KFC, like I'm talking bargain bucket, Zinger Tower.
With the sides.
Like, yeah, cut like 4-pack of Stella, got into my hotel room and just lay there crying. And then the guy texts going, "We won't need you tomorrow."
Oh,
like,
no.
Like, you know when you're like, anyone, I even now, like I'm digi, thinking anyone who is in that fucking... like in that like fucking tent watching me I'll never win back. I could win an Oscar and they go, remember that cunt at
He was shit. We saw him at Download Festival. He's a piece of shit. there was something about a brutal. I remember one time I did this gig. It was in Margate, right? Oh, not New Margate where the hipsters are moving. This is old Margate. Tom Thumb Theatre. And I'm talking about like people were there, like I remember women had like, I remember I saw this one woman holding a 4-pint with one finger missing, spider tattoos.
Yeah.
And I walk on, people are just shouting, heckling. Then this one guy, big lump. And I had a big high top back in the day, big lump. He goes, oi, shut the fuck up. This cunt looks funny. I mean, just said, carry on, mate. And I did the set and it went fine, but it's just the way this fucking guy said, hey, shut the fuck up.
Man.
This cunt looks funny. And then everyone's like, all right, shut up. It's hard. Good times. Let's wrap up. So you got projects coming out. Anything you want to plug? Anything you want to talk about?
No. I mean, I've got like...
Say, plug is such a
thing
shit
coming out at Christmas, but I'm not allowed to announce it properly. Okay, okay. But yeah, I think... stand-up's the thing.
Great.
And writing and working, you know, the most fun thing has been working with, like, different people, different talent, like, writing with different people, and that's been a real joy. Like, we've got two young guys at Hackney who are writing a thing at the moment about knife crime, but on the other side, I'm working with a guy telling a story about the building of Knock Airport and how that was built, and he's like an old Irish guy who worked with Bono for years. So it's, like, different people. It's, like, been a joy. That's been, like... I can't believe my luck to be working with different people like from different backgrounds. That's
what. Bro, you know what, man? Like, I don't say this often, but you're doing great things, man. And you know what, man? Like, I remember when I first met you, we had done 8 out of 10 cats together.
Yes,
that's where we met. 8 out of 10, and you stole that show. I mean, when you were telling them stories about your pops and about the... I remember the Friends story.
Oh, yeah.
Had me... If you ain't seen that, you go watch that 8 out of 10. I think they definitely put that in the edit because I remember you owned that show, man. Yeah. But bro, man, like, you know, you're pushing something out there that's sort of... And you know, it's actually not embarrassing, but it's something that, you know, it's sort of... Your male ego can get in the way sometimes and you can't tell someone how you feel about the work they produce because you kind of feel like, oh man, But you know, and I don't just say this, is, and I honestly mean this, I remember we spoke in Edinburgh and you, speaking to you and you telling me the stuff and how your mindset is and telling about the stuff you're going on and how you're putting out stuff that's real to you has made me work harder.
Oh, thank
and
you,
it's
man.
Made me realize that, you know, it's better to put that stuff out and risk it than to go safe. And I think, you know, I think it's great what you do. And you don't need me telling you that. You've got the proof is in the pudding of all the work and that. And
as I said to those kids,
and I think you're a good guy, and I'm glad to call you a friend, man. Hopefully we're in friendship category now.
Oh, we are, man. Yeah,
we text sometimes. I don't want to put it out there. But we text sometimes. Me and Big Tom D's fucking text Nan again. You know what I'm saying? And it's casual conversation. How you doing? I'm good, bruv. Do you know what I'm saying? So, and the fact you said you would do this is amazing. And,
thank you for
and hopefully
me.
I get to work with you in the future. I think... you know, and I hope to see all the stuff you do, and I think, you know, it's going to be amazing, and thank you for coming down, and
I think
you know, it's going to be inspiring to motherfuckers out there. So if you haven't seen my brother right here, you know, get to know and start watching it, and thank you for coming down. I really appreciate it, my brother. Thank you so much.
All the best.
Appreciate
thank you, it.